I'm going to give you a very broad overview about vitamin D, and of course the topic is principally talking about immune function, and of course how much, right? And you know, of course, Professor Spitz, and he's always thinking, and so what can I tell you about vitamin D and the immune system? And more importantly, what about toxicity? But this is the issue, right? And so did you hear about Dr. Karimbra and his protocol, right? And happily, he's here. And more importantly, he's using very high doses of vitamin D. And so, but does it work? And what is the mechanism? And of course, what about toxicity? Now, of course, so why does the Institute of Medicine consider the 20-hydroxyvitamin D to be only 20? And the Endocrine Society recommends 30. And so it turns out it's because of this German study, right? That there were 675 Germans ages 20 to 90 years of age, and they died unfortunately in an accident. And Primel and their colleagues got the bone biopsy and got their blood. And what they did was, looking at the bone biopsy, here you can see normal black areas or trabeculae. Here you see a person with severe osteoporosis, hardly any connectivity. But here you see good trabeculae, but then the pink stuff. That pink stuff is unmineralized osteoid, a classic sign for vitamin D deficiency. And so normal trabecular bone, but accumulated osteoid. And they showed even internally that there was osteoid, the pink stuff, red unmineralized osteoid. And what did they conclude? They concluded that 26% had osteomalacia at all ages, right? And 36% had osteoidosis. What does that mean? That the osteoid was buried within the mineralized structure of the bone. And so if you look at the Institute of Medicine, the Institute of Medicine said that this small group of individuals was about 1% of this total. And therefore, IOM said that if you're at least 20 nanograms per ml, you're perfectly fine. But they made a high school error in their judgment, because what they should have done was to take this group over this group. And if you do that, it's actually 24% of otherwise healthy German adults between 21 and 29 nanograms per ml had evidence of vitamin D deficiency bone disease. So Primel had suggested to guarantee sufficiency, you needed above 30. Endocrine Society agrees, and because there are so many different assays out there for 25-hydroxyvitamin D, many that may not be as good as others, that we thought 40 to 60 is a really good range to be in, and up to 100 is considered to be perfectly safe. So is vitamin D deficiency a health issue? Even in the United States, 33% deficient. Worldwide, estimate 60% less than 30 nanograms per ml. So how do you treat vitamin D deficiency? So you could take a multivitamin, but how many are you going to take? You can only take one of these things because A, you're going to choke on them, and B, you get too much vitamin A. And so when your tank is on empty, you get a liter or a gallon of gas? No. So what we did back in 1998 was started giving patients 50,000 units of vitamin D once a week for 8 weeks, equivalent to about 6,500 units a day. But now the docs are doing this, and then they say, well, now you're fine. Or maybe they'll put them on 1,000 units of vitamin D a day, or 800 units of vitamin D a day, and they come back 6 months later deficient. Why? Because you didn't correct the problem. Everybody needs more vitamin D. In fact, what I recommend for my patients, just for compliance, 50,000 units once every 2 weeks. It's equivalent to about 3,300 units of vitamin D.